Last time on Star Trek Voyager.
What the hell is it?
A transwarp aperture. It's less than a light year from Earth.
How many Borg vessels?
We can't get a clear reading, but the graviton emissions are off the scale.
I want every ship in range to converge on those coordinates now.
Yes, Admiral.
Hull breaches on deck 6 through 12.
I can't stay ahead of them, Captain.
The armor is failing.
Where's the nearest aperture?
Approximately 30 seconds ahead. But it leads back to the Delta Quadrant.
Mr. Paris, prepare to adjust your heading.
Yes, ma'am.
Got 18 ships in position. 9 more on the way.
Open a channel.
Open, sir.
This is Admiral Paris. Use all necessary force. I repeat, all necessary force.
Sir, there's a vessel coming through.
Mr. Paris, what's our position?
Right where we expect it to be.
The transwarp network has been obliterated, Captain.
We'll celebrate later. Mr. Tuvok.
Cease fire!
Did it.
We're being hailed.
On screen. Sorry to surprise you. Next time we'll call ahead.
Welcome back.
It's good to be here.
How did you?
It'll all be in my report, sir.
I look forward to it.
Thanks for your help, Admiral Janeway.
Sick bay to the bridge. Doctor to Lieutenant Paris. There's someone here who'd like to say hello.
You better get down there, Tom.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Chakotay, the helm.
Aye, Captain.
Set a course for home.
The order setting a course for home caused her voice to waver. Tension on the bridge eased, encouraging crew to relax. Emotions transferred to her chair as she sat, allowing her to face forward, breathe and savor their return. Be emotional later. Catherine remembered the last times she saw her homeworld. Q presented it, and Captain Braxton denied it. One man teased, another quoted a directive, a temporal prime directive now smashed to smithereens. Both people might have delivered Voyager before today. She understood she'd do it twice. Did this mean Q and the timeship Relativity understand the conclusion to this 7-year journey? Neither stopped Admiral Janeway altering the timeline. Why? Through inaction, did both time travelers enable this violation? She stopped with second-guessing. Temporal mechanics and anticipating the whims of an omnipotent being mattered less. The mental gymnastics distorted everyone's effort, she concluded they knew. Catherine looked at the viewscreen, witnessing sunlight cast over her state of Indiana. Home never appeared so vibrant. Thoughts switched to her mother, Sister Phoebe and Molly, her Irish setter. Everyone in Bloomington, awake and in transporter range. No more borrowed minutes over a long-range communications array. The welcomed ship cruised on impulse towards Earth as chunks of comm traffic from multiple Federation ships swamped ops. A jubilant Ensign Kim, with tears, knocked his captain out of celebration.
Captain, we're receiving hails from the fleet and Earth stations.
She shifted the lump of emotion still in her throat.
No doubt, Ensign. Who knows our friends wanting to congratulate us on those vessels?
Ensign Kim nodded, growing younger. His zest for returning home never faltered. He smiled, weeping, as screen readouts overwhelmed his ability to respond. As Earth orbit neared, the USS Bonshoon's captain inquired how Voyager arrived inside a Borg sphere. Other Federation vessels lingered where Voyager appeared and scanned the debris for technology worth salvaging. Janeway knew several officers on board their escorts. She wrapped the arms of her chair, deciding on who to hail first.
Harry, send out a general hail thanking everyone. I'm sure we'll pay each other a visit soon.
Catherine realized after remarking to her operations officer she'd need preparation time for the onslaught of debriefings. Starfleet headquarters is a hive of rigid, perfectly arranged, musty admiral's offices. Catherine reconsidered the circumstances with their return and half-desired, skipping to the frontier again. She bit her lip, indulging in dark, sarcastic thoughts. The grateful vessel hailed a rushed fleet of ships arranged by Admiral Paris, thanking them. Other vessels arriving late to the Borg engagement expected conflict, not a reunion. For those crews on incoming ships, today almost became the Battle of Sector 001 again. Harry observed the splendid collection of Federation starships. He wondered who would be more awestruck, Tom or himself. Eyes wiped dry, he looked around the bridge. Emotional relief drenched crewmates. Instead of decades, family gatherings were hours away. The unfathomable distance travelled disorientated expectations. Harry glanced at Tuvok, straight-faced as ever, tapping commands into his console. The Vulcan could reason on family or security reports. His posture reflected nothing of today's milestone. A small, genuine smile existed on Seven's face. But Harry lacked Tuvok's perceptive skills. Besides an aunt on Earth, who else did Seven have? In these past 4 years, Voyager cultivated her only family relationships. He wondered about the life choices she'd make. Ensign Kim couldn't spy his commander's face as he stood at ops, his superior piloted in silence. Voyager's first officer possessed ideas Ensign Kim couldn't perceive as entering orbit became palpable. Chakotay stared at his tribe's homeworld, contemplating Maquis history. Such concerns didn't stab at him when planning their arrival. Travel between quadrants in an instant reframed perspectives. The caretaker's displacement wave and a Borg conduit provided tidy, ironic bookends. It's normal for starships to embark on 5 or 8 year deep space missions. He speculated if this crew's 7 year journey symbolized a real difference in hindsight. Peculiar sensations caused him to flare his nostrils and breathe through his nose. This technique allowed for clarity and focus on an old life thought lost. A potential to discover old friends, restore relationships, became attainable and material again. The viewscreen, sprinkled with a dozen starships encircling Voyager, provoked. He wondered if his terrorist cell mattered if everyone arrived a decade later, without Admiral Janeway's help. Seven needed consideration, and tugging on Maquis threads should wait. Better to ask if she wished to travel with him, or if she desired staying Earthbound first. Tomorrow didn't require writing crew evaluations or eating replicator rations. Tomorrow turned uncertain. Ensign Culhane entered the bridge and relieved him of helm control. For a moment, he imagined security officers beaming aboard under orders to secure him in the brig. Chakotay returned to his command seat. He glanced at Seven. His eyes welcomed her attention. Chair leather cushioning his hands felt cool after she answered his look with a smile. Catherine sensed Chakotay's comfort, leaned across, grinning, and said he had the bridge.
I'm going to visit B'Elanna and Voyager's second child.
Captain Janeway marched under instinct to sickbay, as though Voyager remained at red alert. Heightened circumstances on board masqueraded as an emergency. Anticipation towards greeting B'Elanna's baby and the miracle with finishing 7 years of journeying provoked to hasten her stride. Crew members passing in corridors provided further confirmation of Voyager's arrival.
Oh, Captain, thank you,
said Crewman Gilmore.
We're back.
Security Officer Anderson shook her fist at shoulder height. Both knew better than to stop their superior. They shared their gratitude, continuing with assigned duties. Sick bay doors sliced open, but the busy medical bay lay bereft of life.
How can you ignore that face?
Kill,